Teniamo di sviglio is Dirac Delta. Suppose that we have a segment of length 4 times capital L in this direction. One, two, three, four times R from capital L, sorry, from this point to this point. So each of these segments is capital M L long. In this case, let us assume that the total charge Q on this segment, let's hypothesize that this is constant. N is uniformly distributed, so if the distribution is uniform, this means if this length is 4 times L, so let me specify that. So from here to here is capital L in length, from here to here is capital L, and all of them are capital L long. Okay, so for 4L altogether, this Q has to be equal to a uniform linear charge density, lambda, times the total length 4 times capital L. This implies, in fact, that lambda is given by the total charge Q, which is constant, divided by 4 times capital L. So let us choose a Cartesian coordinate system with x-axis as follows. Along this line, this is x. This center of this axis, let's suppose it is right in the middle of this line, so that this point here would be minus 2 times capital L, and this point here would be plus 2 times capital L. Okay, the overall is 4L. This is our vertical axis where we plot small lambda, the density, down here. Okay, so in this case, the density is again associated with a uniform distribution. If we want to obtain a Q, we need to simply find the area, which is the base, 4 times L, times the height of lambda, which in this case is Q over 4L. So let us say that this Q over 4L is a point, let's say, right here. So this point is exactly Q divided by 4 times capital L, okay? So we can sketch a rectangle here. The base of which is 4 times L, and the height of which is Q divided by 4 times L. This area represents the total charge Q, which we can thus obtain formally as the integral. Well, obviously it's between minus 2L and plus 2L, but this charge distribution is zero everywhere else. So we can extend this integral without problems from minus infinite to plus infinite in the dx x direction of lambda defined as such. And this is our charge Q, which again, in this case, is nothing but Q divided by 4 times capital L times 4 times capital L. These two cancel out, and this obviously is Q, as expected. All right, so now we want to keep Q to be constant while, for example, diminishing the size of this segment. So, for example, we can now stop our segment at these two points, minus capital L and plus capital L. Okay? So the second obviously is shorter, is 1/2. In order to maintain the same charge, what does have to happen? It has to happen that the lambda has to become 2 times as large. So the lambda would be now up here, having a value which is Q divided by 2 times L. So it's 2 times as large as down here. So now the rectangle will have a base which is only 2 capital L and a height which is Q over 2 capital L. If we perform this integral now, obviously we obtain again the same charge Q. What happens if we push to the limit where capital L goes to 0 plus? We make it just in the neighborhood of this origin. Well, in that case, Q, the total charge, can still be obtained as an integral between minus infinite and plus infinite of a function lambda in the x, lambda of x, which is uniform, if you want, constant. But unfortunately, this function is ill-defined. And why is ill-defined? Because in the limit for L that goes to 0 plus of lambda, which is this quantity here, we obtain Q divided by 4 times 0, if you want. So 0, that is. So we get something which goes to plus infinite by this definition, okay? All right, so it's an ill-defined function. So it's actually not a function. Lambda is not a function anymore. Instead, lambda is what we call a distribution. So in this specific case, this limit, we can rewrite it as follows. Limit for capital L, which goes to 0 plus. In this case, Q is given by, let's rewrite it one more time to make a mapping, from minus to plus infinite, the x of lambda of x. While the function itself is ill-defined, the area, so now we spike up, basically this rectangle becomes taller and taller and it becomes eventually a spike all the way to infinity here. It's not a function, it's a distribution, and the concept of distribution is that while the integrand is ill-defined, the area beneath this rectangle, which becomes narrower and narrower but taller and taller, remains still constant. So the concept is the same as here. We just make this rectangle with a smaller base, eventually infinitesimally small, and super tall, but the area is the same, the area is the integral. So the integral is still well-defined, is Q, but in this limit, instead of using this ill-defined function, we need to call this quantity lambda of x a distribution, minus to plus infinite of something which we call delta, the Dirac delta, in this case of x. This has to be done in dx, but that's not enough. We want to multiply times Q because this delta itself is normalized. Delta itself is normalized to 1 by definition. For example, it's also used in probabilities, etc. So while delta of x is normalized to 1, in order to get Q, I need to multiply times Q this whole integral. And that, again, is the charge Q. So the integral is well-defined. In other words, the formal definition of a distribution in this case, so lambda of x is nothing but Q times delta x. Delta x is defined as follows. In 1D, a function which is 0 for any point x different than 0, and such that the integral from minus to plus infinite dx lambda of x is equal to 1. Okay, so this is the formal definition. Since it's always normalized to 1, again, we need to multiply times Q to obtain our Q here. So the distribution, this delta of lambda of x is Q times delta x for this 1D problem for linear densities. In 3D, the definition would be with respect to generic vector R from any origin O. Okay, in this case, and this is a point capital P, so delta of R in 3D is defined as 0 when R is different than vector 0, and it's such that the volume integral in the entire space, entire universe, capital omega infinite, dr cube of delta of R equal to 1. All right. So there is an interesting aspect now which we want to look at, and it's the translation of the delta Dirac. So in order to understand that, suppose that we have a unit charge, Q equal 1 coulomb, at a point capital Q in space. So the situation looks like this. So this is the origin of all vectors, which coincides with the point capital Q, where I place a 1 coulomb charge. The observation point will be a point here, capital P, at a distance r from the origin O, which coincides with where Q is located. All right, so in this case, the volumetric charge density associated with this configuration, rho, it's nothing but, let's call it rho of R for a unit charge. So this Q is 1 in 3D. It's nothing but Q, which is 1. And so it's simply, this is simply equal to the delta Dirac, delta in 3D, delta of R. Great, with the 1 in front of it because it's for a unit charge. Now suppose that I want to place my unit charge at a point, instead of this point which coincides with the origin, to another point here, and this point we call it O prime, and so our Q, I want to move it from here to this point O prime, where this distance, we call it R0, R0. Okay, in this case, you can simply show by inverting this R0 in this direction, we use the parallelogram rule. So if this is my inverted R0, you can clearly see that R minus R0 is effectively this diagonal, which correspond, once translated back between O prime and P, to this vector here. So we know, in fact, that this distance now can be defined R prime. It's nothing but R minus R0. Okay, so this is the distance of P with respect to the new source charge. So the source charge, we move it from O to O prime. This is these are the locations of the two scenarios for the source charge. We observe always at the same point, but now when the charge is moved, okay, so this is the new location of the charge. So in that case, in this new scenario, which I sketch here in green, it so happens that rho for a point-like charge with 1 coulomb is going to be nothing but delta of R minus R0. So we translated the Dirac delta by means of this simple construction here, okay, with the parallelogram rule. Okay, if you want to grasp a little bit more the concept of rho, which is a volumetric charge density in 3D, the way to think about that is imagine to have a hard sphere. So this is it's a hard sphere, and we write it somewhere here. We charge, let's say, Q, which again is equal to a constant charge. In this case, we know that rho is uniform and is given by Q divided by the volume of this sphere, which is 4 over 3 pi capital R cube, where capital R is the radius of this sphere, okay? So now what happens, this is in 3D, you need to think about this in 3D, what happens when we push R in the limit to go to 0 plus? We are doing the same thing we've done in 1D with capital L going to 0 plus. Now we concentrate this sphere just in the center in this limiting case. In this case, the volume, of course, becomes 0. So 0 in the denominator, rho becomes ill-defined, like lambda here. So I need to exchange my rho with a delta Dirac, with the total charge given by Q. So when the total charge, instead of being 1 coulomb, is whatever you want, a charge Q, and in that case, we need to represent this rho, again as a function of any location r, as Q times delta of r. And this is true again if this point, this origin here, is the same as the origin from where I calculate or vector distances r with respect to any observation point capital P. Again, if I move this to a new point O prime, I need to translate again by this vector R naught. Using the same notations we've done here, we are going to have delta located at R minus R naught. Okay, there is one last property which is worth discussing for the delta Dirac. And I will let you think about this property in Piazza. The property which I want you to discuss in Piazza, let's write it in this corner down here. What is the integral in the entire space capital omega infinite of a given scalar function f of r that gets multiplied by a delta Dirac r minus r naught, integrated obviously in dr cube? I want that you think about this in Piazza. What is the result of this integral? It's a very simple result, and this is a fundamental property of the Dirac delta. And I want you to meditate about this. We are going to need it eventually when we will do multiple expansions of the electrostatic potential, not in 242, but in 342, but it's an important property which I want you to think about. Okay, so to summarize this video, in this video we discussed the Dirac delta. So in order to introduce it, we introduce a segment in 1D of length 4 times capital L on the x-axis, with a uniform dense charge distribution with an overall charge small q, which results in a uniform distribution lambda, q over 4 times L. This distribution is nothing but this area, okay, where this is the height given by lambda. So if I make this this segment smaller and smaller and I want to keep the same charge q on it, obviously the density becomes larger and larger until it spikes up all the way to infinite. Okay, so it becomes an ill-defined function. Lambda becomes infinite because capital L goes to zero. So it's not a function, it's a distribution. In fact, the property which remains still good, a well-defined property, is the integral of this ill-defined function, which remains still the area beneath, which in this case gives us exactly Q. And we can normalize it to one, and so delta becomes these expressions. Okay, so remember that lambda is delta times Q in 1D. In 3D, of course, is rho is Q times delta. Okay, so these are the properties more formally of the Dirac delta here. We also investigated the translation, and we gave some connection with the case of a hard sphere, which when concentrated in a point becomes a point-like charge. So basically, by means of these techniques, we can rewrite the charge density of a point-like charge using a volumetric density rho, which is Q times delta. Okay, so even a point-like charge, we can use the function usually used for continuous distributions in a volume. This is actually a very important result, which is worth highlighting here. And also another point which we can make to conclude here is that there are other functions which approximate Dirac deltas. For example, a Gaussian is one of these functions, or a Lorentzian, which is similar to a Gaussian somehow. So a Gaussian, once when the limit, in the limit that this bandwidth, which is some characteristic feature of the Gaussian, if this bandwidth becomes, that is the standard deviation, becomes infinitesimally small, the Gaussian approximates Dirac delta. Okay, and that's it.